it's been 20 years since the 1999 Kargil war between India and Pakistan. As the country stops for a second to remember that war and the heroes that some we've lost, some who are still with us. One such hero joins me on the show right now, Colonel Lalit Rai, the commanding officer of the 1st Battalion of Kargil of the Gurkha Rifles. Colonel Rai, good evening and thank you so much for joining us. You've shared your experience several times and a very interesting visceral experience you've shared on Facebook as well. You led a team of, you know, a battalion that you had taken over during the war, which is unusual. You know, people that you were leading for the first time that you didn't have time to actually build a relationship with. I want to understand from you what that was like to first get that responsibility and then to lead them in what you call an impossible mission.
Well, Faye, in my case, it was a little different in the sense that when the actual problem broke out there, I was commanding the 17 Rashtriya Rifles in Doda district, you know. I was already in the thick of things. And one evening, I was very tired. I had come down from an ambush because we've been sitting down in the night for the last two or three nights without any sleep. And my colonel of the regiment was on the phone. And he asked me, would you like to command 1st 11 Gurkha Rifles? They are in the midst of some action there. And we need a commanding officer immediately. And at that time, without any hesitation, I said, yes, I would be willing to command 1st 11 Gurkha Rifles because that's the battalion my father was commissioned into. So it's my proud privilege. And I agreed. And then that set the ball rolling because two helicopters were given. I was taken to the battle area. I still remember as I landed over there, there were a lot of bombardments going on. My battalion was scattered all over the area and battalion sector. So yes, there was a certain amount of apprehension initially because to take up a responsibility this huge, you know, the lives of more than 1,000 men in your hands, not knowing the area, not knowing the situation fully, and also the troops whom I was going to command into battle, which would probably mean their lives also at stake. And I hadn't met most, I mean, almost none of them I had met. So that was a real challenge for me. But one thing I had very clear in my mind was that I am from the same regiment. And there were some junior commissioned officers in the battalion who had sort of brought me up as a child when my father was there. And they had taken me on their cycles. So I knew that some of them would be there and they would know about me, if not at least me personally, physically. So with that in mind, I took up the challenge. And what a challenge it was. But before I even embark upon making any other statement, all I can say is my Gurkha boys, the toughest of the soldiers, best soldiers for the mountains. I mean, the world is yet to see soldiers so strong, so stout, and so brave, and so hardy, and in mountains, especially above 17,000 feet above sea level. It was magnificent. It was fantastic commanding such a force in that area.
Colonel, and yes, yes.
One thing I must say is that.
Yes, go ahead.
20 years have passed, and yet the nation, there are a lot of people who are keen and eager to know, even today, after 20 years, as to what exactly happened in Kargil. I think this augurs very well for the nation. And while some people are skeptical to say that, you know, there's a lot of anti-nationalism and people are not patriotic enough, I beg to differ. I think our people are very patriotic. The only thing is that we need to press the right buttons. Yes, you were saying something, Faye.
Yes. I want to remind our viewers that Colonel Rai received the Vir Chakra in 1999 as well. He was gravely injured during Kargil, but he pressed on and he refused to be evacuated, from what I understand, because you believed that you had to physically lead your men from the front and you couldn't leave them at that time. But the story that you have shared, and I would like for you to tell that story again, because you're right, people still want to hear those stories of bravery. When you led a group of men up a mountain, climbing steep peaks at minus 29 degrees, it was biting cold, and you were being fired upon from the top of that peak, and you still managed, A, to simply stay alive without food or water, and to take that peak and hold it with less than 30 men. Would you tell that story for us, please?
Yes. Well, Faye, a few corrections here and there, but
okay.
Yes, when the day came and I got my chance to have a go at Kalobar top, which was considered one of the toughest bastions right in the heart of the enemy country, the enemy positions. I told my troops, I am willing to take as many bullets on my chest as you would. I will lead right from the front. Actually, I really had no choice because, like I told you before and I shared with you before, the troops had not seen me. So for me to lead these people into battle with their lives at stake, it was imperative that I lead from the front and be with them physically. And that's what I did exactly. I still remember that fateful night. And the night previous prior to the attack, one of my companies, which was located a little away from my battalion, came under a lot of shelling that night. And we had a few casualties. So there was a lot of doubt whether we would be able to go in for the assault with that company, because there were some casualties, and you know, after going through a shelling like that, you're a little shaken up. But I told my boys, don't worry. They have to do what they have to do, but we will do what we have to do. And we embarked upon our march towards Kalobar top. A lot of firing. And especially when we were about 600 yards short of the objective with two companies up, it became a nightmare. It was like a absolute nightmare for me, with bullets whizzing past, must have been about 40 odd machine guns firing at me and on my troops. Bullets whizzing, my boys shattered and mangled with those bullets. It was a terrible, terrible, terrible time for me as a commanding officer. And every time one of my troops fell down with bullet injuries, I would sit down, take this boy on my lap, put an ice ball to stop the flow of blood, and I would talk to the boys and tell him, look, I can't stop here for you, neither can I leave anyone behind to look after you. But remember this, once the objective is captured, I will come down and carry you on my own shoulders and I'll take you down. And look at the bravery of my boys. They said, sir, we are almost absolutely drained of blood. So much of blood is oozing out. I feel hollow. I feel weak. And I don't want to die. But we know that getting to the objective in time is more important. So please do it fast and come back and save us. And with that type of the incidents happening all along, we moved ahead. When we were around 400 yards short of the objectives, all hell broke loose. And my objective was Kalobar top. But I noticed there was tremendous amount of fire coming from my southern flank onto the left. That was from the bunker area. And that was the time, since all my company commanders were scattered, the troops were scattered because of so much of fire and high intensity of fire. So I got hold of Captain Manoj Pandey, who was by my side. And I explained to Manoj, I said, look, we need to rush to the top. I need someone to rush to bunker area while I rush to the top at Kalobar top. Otherwise, we'll all be butchered and we'll be daylighted. Look at this brave boy. He didn't hesitate for a moment, and with his platoon, he moved and headed towards bunker area. While with the rest of them, I told them, sar mein kafan bandho aur ye mat socho ki hum wapas zinda aayenge. Because if you try to save yourself, if you try to save your limbs, we'll never make it to the top. And then someone gave that beautiful battle cry, Jai Mahakali, and everybody said, Ayagur Kali, and we charged up. So let me explain what happened here with Captain Manoj Pandey's action. When Manoj Pandey went up to the bunker area, where we thought there were only four bunkers firing at us, when he went up, he reported there were actually six of them. Two of the bunkers were slightly enfiladed and echeloned behind, for which he sent Hawaldar Bibi Dewan with his section to finish that off. And this young Hawaldar, again, another brave boy, charged head on because there was no other option, there was no other way that he could have gone to those bunkers. And he finished those two bunkers. But in the bargain, he got martyred. But he completed his task. And after that, Captain Manoj Pandey started hitting one bunker, destroying one bunker after the other. And this actually entailed doing the fire and move tactics and getting closer and closer to the bunker till you come close enough, crawl under the hail of bullets, almost 1,000 rounds a minute from the machine gun, and then suddenly get up and throw the grenade into the loophole. And after that, finish the job with the kukri. So while they were finishing the third one, Captain Manoj Pandey got a few bullets on his left side of the body and he started bleeding profusely. So the boys told him, Saab, you let us now do the job. You watch and we will finish the job for you. That's the last bunker left out there where the machine gun is firing. And Manoj Pandey, a very, very spirited boy, he said, look, the commanding officer has given me the job to finish this bunker area and it will be my privilege that I at least complete the job and I give him the victory sign to say that I have completed my task. It will be a proud privilege for me. And this boy crawled towards the bunker. But sadly, he had lost so much of blood and because of the cold and the injuries and the weakness, he got up to throw the grenade. He threw the grenade, which found the mark. But meanwhile, the Pakistanis saw him and fired four bullets right through the skull and through the helmet, bursting his head off almost. And he fell down. But even as he fell and the first bullet had just about made the impact, he yelled out, Na chodno. He told his boys. That was his last words, Na chodno. That is, don't leave them. The boys were in a frenzy when he saw that happening. They charged with their kukris and they slaughtered the whole lot of them, and that's how bunker area was taken. Meanwhile,
Colonel,
with the rest of the battalion. Yes.
Yes. I do want to ask you this. You have talked about how many men were lost in that mission that you led. And you've also, I remember reading, you said that even today, you wake up in the middle of the night hearing that machine gun fire, hearing the cries of your men. And overseas, we've learned now that a lot of the forces train or treat their people for PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder. Do you think that perhaps that's something we're doing enough of in India, making sure that young people or making sure that our men from our forces who come back from the front are given enough help to get back onto their feet and rehabilitate into society after that trauma?
Well, to be fair, I would say that post-traumatic care professionally by psychiatrists are not done. However, the environment within the battalion is such where there are very experienced soldiers. There's a mix of these young people with the very, very trained soldiers. And they are the stress busters. They are the people who actually get them back into line, into their daily livelihood. So to an extent, I think the bonding is so strong in the Indian Army. It's unlike other armies. Here it's more like a family, where the commanding officer is the father figure, the company commanders are like the elder brothers. So what happens is when they come back, we sit down together, we share our experiences, and then slowly, slowly, we try to sort of gel and bond with each other and talk it out over there, which sort of dispels and, you know, removes all the stress from within you. But yes, I think we need some amount of professional psychiatrists to come and do some sessions so that a little de-stressing could be done on that. There is scope for that.
And Gurkha Rai, I must also ask you about this. After you took the peaks and the areas that you were told on your mission, you managed to hold them for 48 hours with very few men. When the enemy knew that, you know, you were running out of ammunition, again, it was testimony to simply the grit,
yes,
and the determination of yourself and your men, wasn't it?
You know, Faye, when we were on top, one lost count of time. We were lying with the dead bodies all over there. The whole area was absolutely drenched with blood. We were absolutely red with so much of blood flowing there. It was absolutely cold, minus 32 degrees ambient temperature. When it snowed, we covered it. It really covered us up, and we had to sort of dig yourself up. When it rained, we were drenched to the teeth. There was no food. There was no water because there was a whole break in communication because of the intensity of fire. So almost those 3 nights and 4 days without a drop of water, without a single morsel of food, without a wink of sleep. We didn't even go to relieve ourselves because we didn't want to lose the precious body fluid. It was a terrible time for me. However, I don't even recollect how many counterattacks we beat back. I still remember scrounging all the dead bodies around there of the enemy soldiers, taking their own weapons, taking their ammunition, firing it on them, using ours, grenades, everything. And at the end of it, when everything was almost over and we were just 8 on top and we were surrounded and the counterattack was coming, I thought, now this is the time I'm going to go. All sort of imaginations, how is it going to happen? Is it going to be a burst of bullets through my belly, my face? Will it be a bayonet? You know, those type of thoughts. But then I remembered that certain fire units would be now available. And that is how we asked for some SOS fire, that is fire on our own heads from the artillery units. And then we got those SOS fire and that saved the day. And of course, on the fourth night or so, we got a Tiranga Chanda and we put it on top of Kalubar top.
You asked for the Indian Bofors guns to fire at the location that you had taken at that point. How did you make sure that you and your 8 other men were safe?
Well, you know, we knew the direction from where the guns were coming, the fire was coming from Marpola side. We knew where the shrapnels would travel. The Pakistanis didn't. They were abusing you and we were abusing them. It was one of those very, very funny scenarios where the enemy is actually talking to you. And then they were there in the open. We were hiding behind those boulders over there. So we knew which direction it was coming. We did get some shrapnels on us, but nothing lethal. But those guys were absolutely shattered over there because they were caught in the open.
I also want to understand I want you to describe to us what that was like to actually finally have someone come up, discover you, give you food and water and hand you a Tiranga to put on that, on that peak that you had taken back.
Oh, that elation was fantastic. I mean, you felt so relieved when you saw your own men over there. The relief was tremendous. And But the tiredness was so much that you were literally almost falling off. And we had more operations and more phases to go. So we could hardly even stand up after that, you know. But I mean, it's quite natural that you feel very, very elated that you held on and you stuck on and you did it. But what saddened me was the loss of my boys. Some of the people, they got martyred over there. Some were missing in action. That was very sad. And the first concern was, how many have gone? Where are the guys who are missing? When were they last seen? And what was my total casualty? not only in terms of those people who are martyred, but also on those people who have been wounded, whether we have been able to evacuate them. Because as a commanding officer, your own pain and your own injuries are of no consequence. You are more concerned about how your command is, how your boys are, and that's what makes the Indian Army great.
Colonel Lalit Rai, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for everything you've done and for the sacrifice that you and your men have put forward for India and for your bravery. Jai Hind, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Faye. Jai Hind.
Well, that was Colonel Lalit Rai, Vir Chakra, someone who led a battalion to the front, absolutely in the face of fire, freezing temperatures, and an impossible, impossible task that he achieved. Complete, almost fairy tale story of bravery, grit, and determination, and love for one's country. And of course, the massive sacrifices that have been made by the families who lost their loved ones in that war. Meena Nair joins us right now, mother of Captain Anuj Nair. Captain Anuj Nair was lost during the Kargil War. Ms. Nair, first of all, obviously from the entire country at this point, the gratitude that we feel for the sacrifice that your son has made is something we cannot express in words. But the pain for your family is obviously far more personal. It has been 20 years. But does it feel like it has been 20 years when you look back at the loss and the victory? Right now, 20 years on, what do you remember most?
This was a pretty long time, and many ups and downs came. Lived without Anuj, it was not an easy job, you know. So many struggles were there. Now looking after petrol pump, and we are writing a book and revisiting the past. Every day, every moment, Anuj as a child, Anuj as a young man, Anuj as an army officer, he was my life. So living without him is not an easy job. But I have to take life as it comes. What I feel is that, you know, happiness you can distribute with everyone, but suffering is your own. You have to take it. जैसे भी आपको लेना पड़े यू हैव टू टेक इट सो आई एम टेकिंग इट क्वाइट ब्रॉडली एंड वर्किंग ऑल डे एंड नाइट
और मैम जब कैप्टन अनुज नायर पोस्टिंग पे गए थे क्या उन्होंने आपसे बात की थी आपकी आखिरी बात उनसे क्या थी डिड ही टेल यू दैट ही वाज बीइंग सेंट टू द फ्रंट
No, ma'am. He was in the war. हमें उसने नहीं बताया था एंड काफ़ी दिन पहले मेरी बात हुई थी तो मैंने उसको पूछा था कि ये न्यूज़पेपर में रोज़ कारगिल आ रहा है बेटा तू वहाँ पर है कहता नहीं मैं वहाँ पर नहीं हूँ एंड उसके मेजर रितेश शर्मा ने मुझे फ़ोन किया था कि अनुज के लिए आपको कुछ भेजना है तो मैंने उसको बोला अनुज ने दो सीडीज़ मंगाई थी हुतू तू एंड बॉम्बे बॉयज़ मैं वो भेजना चाहती हूँ उसके कमांडर ने मुझे बताया कि मैडम वो तो वॉर में है दैट वाज द डे यू नो हमें पता चला एंड अनुज की डेथ हुई है 6 जुलाई को हमें ब्रिगेड से फ़ोन आया था ब्रिगेडियर गिल का उन्होंने कहा कि मैंने अभी अभी अनुज को एक सीरियस ऑपरेशन के लिए भेज रहा हूँ एंड आई जस्ट विश्ड हिम गुड लक तो आई वॉज लिटल यू नो स्टर्नड मैंने उनको पूछा कि उसके पास बुलेट प्रूफ जैकेट एंड शूज़ सब है उन्होंने कहा आई हैव सीन एवरीथिंग मैं उसके आगे कुछ कह नहीं पाई उनको एंड यू नो दैट नाइट वाज इवन ऑल दोज डोज देयर्स वर वेरी डिफ़िकल्ट कि हम लोग सारी सारी रात जागते थे हैंडसेट फ़ोन अपने पास रखते थे उन दिनों में मोबाइल तो थे नहीं तो सुबह 9:45 पे उसका मैसेज आया था ब्रिगेड से वो मेरे हस्बैंड ने उठाया था तो उन्होंने कहा कि अनुज इज़ नो मोर एंड फ्रॉम दैट पॉइंट यू नो लाइफ चेंज ड्रेस्टिकली
मैम उस दिन के अभी 20 साल हो गए इट हैज़ बिन 20 ईयर्स क्या आपको लगता है यू टॉक्ड अ लॉट इज वेल अबाउट जो कॉम्पनसेशन मिलती है फैमिलीज़ को जो पेट्रोल पंप दिया जाता है जी दिया गया कारगिल वॉर हीरोज़ की फैमिलीज़ को आपने कहा कि ये काफ़ी नहीं है कंट्री शुड बी वर्किंग द कंट्री शुड बी वर्किंग टूवर्ड्स सिक्योरिटी टूवर्ड्स प्रोटेक्टिंग आवर सन्स क्या आप अभी भी वैसे ही फील करते हो
यस यस मैम यही फील करती हूँ. देखिए पेट्रोल पंप देना, पेट्रोल पंप में हम लोग बिजी हो गए, ठीक है, बट यू नो देखिए यहाँ कहीं तो स्टॉप होना चाहिए. आफ्टर 20 ईयर्स अभी भी यू नो कितनी सारी डेथ्स हो रही हैं फौजियों की वहाँ पर. डेली हम लोग देखते हैं फेसबुक पे कि भाई अपना फ्लैग्स रैप्ड बॉडीज आ रही हैं. तो जो भी गवर्नमेंट को करना है, गवर्नमेंट शुड एक्ट. रोज़ रोज़ आप हम अपने ब्रेव बच्चे कितने मरवा लेंगे, इतने बच्चे आएंगे कहाँ से मैम.
मैम क्या
कुछ तो सोल्यूशन देखो ये गवर्नमेंट को निकालना पड़ेगा. पॉजिटिवली भेजा था.
और उनकी उनकी उस टाइम पे मंगनी भी हुई थी, वो शादी करने वाले थे.
उस नहीं मैम उसकी एंगेजमेंट हो गई थी 98 में. 11 अप्रैल 98 को उसकी एंगेजमेंट हुई थी एंड 10 सितंबर 99 उसकी मैरिज फिक्स हो गई थी. तो अभी वो सब अपनी शॉपिंग वगैरह करके गया था. इवन ब्राइड ग्रूम ड्रेस एंड एवरीथिंग यू नो इट वाज डन. तो बट ही नेवर केम बैक. 28 अप्रैल 99 में वो यहाँ से गया था ड्यूटी पे. उसके बाद वो वापस नहीं आया.
नायर हमारे साथ बात करने के लिए बहुत धन्यवाद. अगेन वी थैंक यू एज सिटीजन्स ऑफ दिस कंट्री, सिविलियन सिटीजन्स, वी थैंक यू फॉर द सैक्रिफाइस दैट यू हैव मेड एंड वी स्टैंड विद यू इन योर हार्डशिप एंड वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट एवरी डे द पेन रिमेन्स द सेम. वी थैंक कैप्टन अनुज नायर फॉर द सैक्रिफाइस ही मेड फॉर आर कंट्री एज वेल. That was the mother of Captain Anuj Nair, someone who was lost during Kargil. As 20 years on, unfortunately, while we've moved on as a country, we go on with our lives day by day. For the families who've lost loved ones, the pain remains like it happened yesterday.